Ora si registrerà la conferenza.
Okay, so good morning everybody and welcome. And this is a new initiative of our SEALS Association. And it will be a calendar of 1 hour meetings, very friendly meetings of two people. At the same time, they will meet in front of a virtual cafe and they will exchange scientific ideas. And so it's my great pleasure to start the first meeting together with Giancarlo Panaccione from the Institute of Materials of CNR and Stefano Toso from the Italian Institute of Technology. They are the starters, and so our test. Stress test will be done with them. And they will present the results in this 1 hour time. And I will now share, interrupt this screen and share with Giancarlo, who is the first speaker, sorry, I have to find him. Ecco, ok. So you are the next speaker, and now you can share your screen. And meanwhile, I want to introduce him. So Giancarlo is a research director at the Institute of Materials of CNR Institute. He's at the same time responsible of the Spring Lab at Fermi, and he's also the interface of the Institute regarding quantum material research. So it's my great pleasure to give him the floor.
Thanks. Thanks a lot for the invitation and nice idea to share a coffee virtually between, in particular today, it's here and in the United States. So it's a long wire from here to the United States. I hope that you see my pointer somewhere. Yes, I do see a pointer. And this is the outline on my talk where I would like to try to convince you that quantum materials are a vast and interesting subject or field of research. And I will also try to give you some examples regarding the study of these materials with the X-ray, and in particular using photoelectron spectroscopy. That is one of the electron spectroscopies possible using an X-ray source and a synchrotron. And I will conclude with some perspectives and something that I consider a possible future direction for this kind of activity. So let's start with the idea and with the with showing you that one real revolution has been done and happened roughly in the 50s. Between the 40s and the 50s, with the semiconductor revolution, the invention of the bipolar transistor and the technology that is called the CMOS technology, corresponding to the metal oxide semiconductors and the transistors, made the technology available for anyone and made possible the passage from this big monster here that was at that time the most powerful computer, able to do something like 5,000 operation for a second, but weighing something like 30 tons and using 200 kilowatts of electrical plants. From this in the 50s, we now pass to something that you know very well, and it's much more powerful in performing with respect to the beginning, and has much more technology and the power than anything used, for example, to go to the moon at the time in which the Apollo missions were used. So this means that this was really a revolution in terms of technology. And one motivation for a next possible revolution is that the Moore law, established by the co-founder of Intel, says that somehow the surface used for building up a certain number of transistors should shrink or as a function of the time down to nanometer, and increasing the number of transistors from the same given area. This, for example, is visible here, where the evolution from the 90s to today has been following more or less the Moore's law. And I would say that each year, many papers and many contributions in the field of research suggest that we are now at the limit of the Moore's law. But at the end, next year, the companies able to perform this technological improvement of reducing the number, increasing the number of transistors while reducing their area, they are still there, and they are still within the CMOS technology able to do this work properly. So here you see a new approach or nanowire, nanocarbon transistor. This is nanotechnology and quantum material, where the nanotechnology and quantum material may enter. We are still asking ourselves if this is true or not, and if this will become a new technology. For the moment, this is only in the research field, but it's one interesting and appealing research field. Okay, and this was the estimation that I put between the difference in terms of money between something bought or costing a value in 2010 and what is the estimation for 2030. Okay, now the revolution or the possible revolution of quantum material is that starting from the discovery of graphene that won the Nobel Prize at the Professor Novoselov, a certain number of materials were the description in terms of properties, electronic properties and magnetic properties, electric properties, of their behavior is not simply or relatively simply explained in with a single electron band model. This corresponds to the fact that the combination between the nanotechnology growth, understanding of the systems in a layer by layer fashion gives some new possibility to the functionality or to the collective behavior of solids. And this is the timeline where the quantum technologies may address something similar to a new revolution as the one of the semiconductor one. So this means that from the point of view of the researcher, both experimentally and theoretically, we should explore the applicability of these quantum materials, trying to get a full control of the systems down to the atomic level. And if I took here a prediction and a report from the Basic Energy Science Committee of already 10 years ago, where one of the basic challenges for research in solid state physics was to pass from the control age, sorry, to arrive to the control age, passing from starting from the observation age. So this means that the idea was to try to explore in any direction, in time, length, and energy scale, the properties of this material, and try to pass from the simple observation age to the control of the functionality of this system. And this is written here, creating a new language for the behavior of electron. This is a phrase or a concept that is at the core of the usage or of the understanding or of the research focused on quantum material. And to do this, you need a playground. And the playground that I will try to describe today is a synchrotron radiation source with their beamlines that being hosted by the Italian Synchrotron Radiation Society. I believe and I hope that this is well known as a possible tool for study matter. And exploring in time, length, and energy scale using this. Some of these parameters, or all of these parameters that we know are available at very many synchrotron radiation beamline. And in specifically, what I will show is the importance of the tunability of the high intensity in terms of what a beam coming from a synchrotron beamline may perform. And the technique that you may use, and that I will try to introduce, is photoelectron spectroscopy. Photoelectron spectroscopy is an old lady. Kai Siegmann in 81 has been awarded of the Nobel Prize for the development of this technique that was called the ESCA at that time, and based on the fact that the chemical sensitivity of the technique was one of the most important parameter that you may exploit. And the second point is a photon in electron out technique, as show here, in which you have your solid sample, you analyze the photoelectrons that are emitted from the sample. The third important point is that it's a very simple relation based on the photoelectric effect between the energy of the photon that arrives on your sample, the work function of your sample, and the binding energy of the electrons that are inside your sample, meaning you are measuring kinetic energy and momentum, spin, etc. But this is a very simple relation, and this gives you immediately the hint that this is a chemical sensitive technique because the binding energy of each element is different with respect to the other. So by measuring the kinetic energy, you are able to detect what is the element, what is the orbital symmetry. So this means that photoemission is a direct probe of electronic and magnetic properties. And you see here an example of a manganite, lanthanum strontium manganese oxide, in which you see that the spectrum of photoemission has a lot of peaks. These peaks are corresponding to deep core level, as in this case, or corresponding to extended states close to the Fermi level here, where you have the valence band. And I will show you a couple of examples of possible studies, both for core level and for valence band. Why photoemission? I was trying to mention something in the previous slide. The basic principle is that you shine your X-ray on your sample, you analyze your electron in many different ways, and what gives you photoemission is, for example, a relatively straightforward comparison with theory. Here we have an experimental peak, and this is a cluster calculation of the same peak in which you may understand what are the electronic configuration of the system. So comparison, not only straightforward, but also direct. The second point is that photoemission may span for very different energy scales, from milli electron volt to electron volt, covering so very different excitation or interaction in the solids. And again, information about the chemical state. This is an example of platinum and rhodium in which you may have peaks coming from the surface or coming from the bulk as a function of the reconstruction or the layer by layer deposition on the surface of something. And so the structure and the presence of the peak will give you information about the chemical environment. And this is good for chemistry and for physics. And so the first example that I would like to implement is that by spanning the photon energy, spanning the photon energy is one of the characteristics that you have at the synchrotron beamline, you may change from surface sensitive to bulk sensitive experiment. And in the case in which you are interested to a buried interface, for example, changing the photon energy will give you information of what happens at the interface that is deep in the solid. So photoemission at a synchrotron will give you a depth sensitivity and is not destructive. So it's something in which you may change and span from one to from lower photon energy to higher photon energy, changing the probing depth accordingly. And I would like to stress that 80 angstrom of probing depth may seem nothing to someone that is not working with electron spectroscopies, but from the point of view of the surface sensitivity of photoemission that can go down to a single angstrom, an order of magnitude or two orders of magnitude of probing depth means bulk sensitivity. And this is an example in which you have a silicon 1S core level photoemission, in which as a function of the probing depth, you may see still a signal coming from down from 13 nanometer of your solid, and this is considered really bulk sensitive. So what is the possible use of this bulk versus surface sensitivity? One possible use is to explore what are the differences, for example, in oxides. This is an oxide, a magnetic oxide, in which by measuring the core level, the 2p core level, you may see that as a function of the increasing of the photon energy, you see appearing of a peak. This peak correspond to a different screening of the electrons in the solid. You may follow this intensity, and after peak fit, your intensities and your core level measurement, and by peak fit in this, you may extract what is the layer in which you have this strange metallic thickness, or what is the difference between the surface and the bulk. And here is the example for two material. This is manganese doped GIS, in which you have a certain screening of the electrons in the bulk and a small portion of much localized electrons here by peak fitting your core level structure. And this is the case of lanthanum strontium manganese oxide, in which your layer of reduced metallic screening is much bigger. And this is important in importance in terms of spintronic or interface you would like to exploit. So this is one application. Another application that I would like to mention among the several ones is The possibility of exploiting photoemission while you are applying a stimulus to your sample. This is called inoperando, typically, and this is the example that I show is when you apply an electric field to a very complicated structure that is starting from a substrate and has a bottom and a top electrode and several interfaces. So exploiting, first of all, the fact that you are sensitive to the chemical environment, you are sensitive to the specific element, you may measure as a function of the bias, and you see this is the evolution of your peaks or your core level peaks, and this is the case of rhodium 3D and zirconium 3D that are here in the buffer of this complicated structure. And at the same time, by applying in this system the electric field, you are forming a state that is resistive, changes resistance as a function of the voltage that is applied. So this means that your titanium, in this case, this is titanium dioxide, change as a function of the different states in terms of high resistivity or low resistivity, and you are online. But while you are measuring, you have a possibility of seeing what are the differences in terms of the oxidation states while the resistive state are forming in your body the interface. And so this is again important for application and for device application. Okay, another example is what happens if you have a very good control of your systems and you put together, for example, two insulators? An insulator is defined as a system that has no states at the Fermi level. So if you put together two insulators, this is the case of lanthanum aluminate and strontium titanate, you have sudden deformation of a 2D electron gas. So in some sense, you have a property that does not exist in A and B, in the two insulator, and appears only if you put A and B together. And this is an example of what is the control of the heterostructure, the interfaces of quantum material, in which you produce a property that does not exist in the two components. And this has been measured for the first time in LOSTO, but there are many, many systems in which this happens. And this corresponds to an atomically precise electronic property in terms of control of the heterostructure and of the interface. And this can be expanded to down to the single layer. So in many of the quantum materials you have, you may have at your lab, you may build up heterostructure with the specific structure, so entering in the control of the dimensionality of your system. So this is an epitaxy in which you may do a kind of Lego, and starting with the properties of different system and putting them together in such a way to exploit or have a specific property or a specific quantum effect coming from the combination of these different little pieces of the Lego. And this corresponds again to play with the dimensionality, starting from dimensionality number two, where you have this two-deg electron system, down to nanowires or up to a normal system. And again, when photoemission may enters into play, is that photoemission, and now I'm shifting to the low energy scale of the use of this technique, may enter directly in K-space, meaning that they may enter directly in the relationship between momentum of the electrons and energy, and may have a vision or may understand the differences in interaction of a specific solid. So starting from a free electron, the photoemission may via photoemission, via angular resolved photoelectron spectroscopy, you may understand electron-phonon coupling, electron-electron coupling, you may understand spin-orbit coupling, and for each of these you have a specific fingerprint, electronic or spectroscopic fingerprint to be seen and to be addressed in photoemission. And moreover, working close to the Fermi level, you may have access to the valence state near the electron Fermi energy or the electron Fermi level. And this corresponds to many of the important properties that you have in your solid system, spanning from superconductivity, magnetism, magnetoresistance, etc. And this is an example of what you may do using ARPES and joining the information that you may have at the Fermi level with the dimensionality. So the Fermi surface is, probably you know better than me, but I repeat that the Fermi surface is the piezoenergetic surface corresponding to the Fermi level, where the value of that is dividing the occupied and the unoccupied states. So is the place where, again, most of the properties occur. And the surface, the Fermi surface and the Fermi level, they change as a function of the dimensionality. So in one dimension is corresponding to these small circles. In two dimension is a complete circle. In three dimension is a kind of sphere for a simple metal. And what you may do with photoemission is exactly to look directly to this. So this is the parabola that is corresponding to this cut here. These are the circular shape of a free electron in a solid. This is copper, corresponding to the Fermi surface of the of a solid. So you are looking directly, entering in K-space, to this specific place. And when we come back for a moment to the 2D electron gaze that you produce at the Fermi level of two insulators, you may see this directly. These are spectrum at the Fermi level. You see this is zero energy, so the border between occupied and unoccupied states. And for each of these elements, you see a different kind of electron states at the Fermi level that are produced by the fact that there is an insulator, and with different shape, different peaks that corresponds to different electronic properties. And again, there is a list of Fermi surfaces of solids, and by using photoemission and ARPES, you may check what are the importance or the differences with respect to what is the nominal photon energy. This is both in interface and in normal solids. These are some examples. This is the Fermi surface of tungsten 110, taken from a very nice talk from Eli Rothenberg. This is the Fermi surface. These are cut, vertical cuts of what you may have here, cutting your 3D surfaces. This is a comparison between a theoretical and experimental result for beryllium, in which you see that the theoretical Fermi surface should display this kind of cigar here. And these cigars are this, because they are cut horizontally with respect to the to this plane, in which you see, you observe this. You may play with the circular or linear polarization in order to extract what is the full Fermi surfaces. And this is an evolution of the iron 100 Fermi surface made of horizontal cutting, in which you enter in the solid and you see what is the difference in orbital structure of the electronic states close to the Fermi level. Okay, so the message and the methodology that is suggested for quantum materials is the following: to try to get a new revolution on quantum materials. So is A circle in which you start with theory and chemistry and you exploit growth, and after you go to characterization at lab and synchronous and back to theory to try to understand what is the opportunity or the little modification that you may have in order to get your property done and your functionality work. And three slides on the future. Cinzia, do I have 3-4 minutes?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, so three slides on the future. One is nano photoemission that I believe this could be one of the argument of the chat with Dr. Toso in the next, because I believe that is something related to nano much more than what I was showing here in my talk. So one is that photoemission, but not only, say electron spectroscopy, they may go nano in the future. They did already very nice job. This is an example in which you put together, as I was mentioning, the Lego of different transition metadegradable cogenide of quantum material, one on top of the other, in order to get your specific property. And this is an example in which you may perform nano ARPES looking as a function of the place where these specific elements are at the monolayer or at the bilayer, and you see that there are differences in the spectrum and difference in the calculated and theoretical expectation. The second point that is also important and on which the free electron laser will enter and are trying to enter into play is to use time resolution, meaning decoupling electron spin and lattice from their critical time scale and have a look and observe what is the critical time scale of a phenomena and interaction in a solid. This is an example for magnetism in which as a function of the different length and time you have different interaction to be studied, and this is a list of spanning from femtosecond to picosecond, what are the relevant time scale of the interaction. That in a solid, if you measure statically, they are all together in the same place, but if you are applying a pump probe system, exciting the system to a very high effective electronic temperature, you may try to decouple and see differently or specifically. And the third future is the most challenging one that I call the digital twin, meaning this is a marriage between theory and experiment. This is a very nice example that is made by a group at the Fritz Haber Berlin. Here there is a link of the archive in which they produce a feedback from the theoretical and experimental results. This is an example in ARPES, but this is valid for many others, in which not only the feedback, but also the operation is made online. So we may imagine of an experiment in which while we are acquiring something, we have a theoretical support that explain us what are the differences with respect to the theory. For example, what are the differences between the volume, the bulk properties and the surface properties. And by adjusting this feedback online, you get results and comparison much faster and much reliable with respect to what is what we do now, in which we have to spend much more time in order to understand better what are we measuring and in order to give the feedback to the theoretical colleagues. Okay, 1 minute for a few advertising messages. We are there. That is Elettra, Fermi, the lab, the beamlines. IOM is more or less here. And we are a group working in a facility And the Nanoscience Foundry and Final Analysis, a European project in which we host European and Italian project in which we host users. So if you are interested in performing experiment, including growth characterization and spectroscopy and theory, you are welcome to apply, and we will be happy to help you and give you suggestions. And this is the last slide with the acknowledgement of all the people that are doing something while I'm only talking and doing nothing, in which in the three declination of our experimental work, so the beamline, the spin ARPES facility that is at a low energy beamline, and the time resolved laboratory sprint. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very
Ah.
much. Very nice.
Now I drink something.
Drink a coffee.
Another coffee.
So I want to know if somebody has questions, because I would leave the question from Stefano at the end. So just from the audience, there are questions specifically to what Giancarlo explained us.
Don't shoot on the pianist.
Well, maybe while the other maybe are thinking a little bit more, I'm very basic questions, mm-hmm. which are the size range of a quantum effect. Very basic question. And the other one is, beside the size, do we talk about quantum also when we have coherent effects, that means where we leave the linearity to a superlinearity field?
Ah. So the definition of quantum is very wide. This is clear, no? Say we, for example, I assume I speak a lot. And also when we do meeting in our group or in the lab or with colleagues, our field, say our quantum field, is still very big with respect to what is considered big in terms of surface area, number of atoms, number of effect. So mostly of the things that I was presenting are related to quantum effects that correspond to collective effect. Okay, so when I was speaking about interactions that ARPES may give say useful hints, we are always speaking about collective interactions. Okay. So when we go down to the confinement, it's an artificial confinement. So meaning that we are producing quantum wells. We are producing stepped surfaces where only one mono chain of an atom can arrange. Okay. But it's a kind of artificial quantum confinement. While what our colleagues of optoelectronic and optics and laser and cold atoms are meaning, they are much more single photon, single electron, single effect. Okay, so. And this is one point. The second point is the coherence, for example. No, the coherence, obviously, one of the development of the next generation of synchrotron radiation sources is to exploit coherence. And this means exploiting quantum effect, I would say, at the bridge between what I mentioned of quantum and what the colleague of photon and cold atoms, they mean. Because the coherence that you have in the beam may help you in the understanding, but also in the vision of specific quantum properties. Okay.
Okay, so there are still time for other questions after Stefano's talk, so I will give him the floor.
Okay, I close my screen.
Thank you, Cinzia.
Okay, while he's preparing, I want to say that Stefano is still a PhD student, although I have met him because he's a PhD student of Liberomanna, where with Libero we work since many years. And once he told me, Cinzia, there is a brilliant student of my group who would like to come to learn some philosophy. So Stefano came, and since then our collaboration never stopped. And that's a very good example of very good student, very brilliant one. So my great to give you the floor.
Thank you, Cinzia. It's a too good presentation for me. I really appreciate it. Do you see my screen correctly?
Yes.
Okay, good. So yeah, as Cinzia mentioned, I'm still a PhD student, so my talk will be a bit more focused on what we actually do and a bit less on the broad view, of course, than Giancarlo did. And yes, he's correct. We go a bit more nano probably than the materials he is used to. I am a nanochemist. That means that in Libero's group and the group I belong to, we develop nanomaterials through colloidal chemistry. We like basically do wet chemistry in solution to control the materials at the nanoscale. The group is situated in Genova at again IIT, Istituto Italiano di Tecnologia. And we mostly work on semiconductor nanocrystals. So I don't know what's the background of the audience in this respect, so I will just give a brief introduction to the class of materials. When we talk about a nanomaterial, what we mean is that we are basically cutting the solid state down to very, very, very small pieces. And those pieces are in the range between 5 and 100 nanometers. Here, basically, the lower limit is because if you go below, you enter the molecule domain. So it doesn't really make sense anymore to talk about nanocrystal. You can push it maybe a bit more. And above 100 nanometers, on the contrary, mostly you lose the quantum performances, the quantum effects that are characteristic of such confined small sizes. So that's why we refer to this range. And since those are colloidal systems, they must be protected on the surface. That's why you have these kind of hairy structures on the surface of the nanocrystal that are actually organic molecules, and they surround the surface and protect them from merging to each other and starting growing bigger crystals. So that's actually how a nanocrystal look like. This might seem like fancy science, but nanoparticles in general are already being used extensively in several fields of science, like food industry, for example. You have them as antimicrobials, you use them as fertilizers, as pesticides, there are some colorants. In medicine, they are used for drug delivery. They are also used a lot, for example, in cosmetics. In heavy industry, the most renowned application is catalysis, probably, but also they are used as additive in fuels and as in lubricants. And in electronics, well, that's the field that we are working on, so I will just zoom in a bit. We're mostly talking about quantum dots. This is a word that is coming up more and more often, also in like public news. They are using sensors. They are being studied extensively in solar cells. And probably the most commercially available application at the moment is in screens. There's like they have been recently presented to the wide public OLED quantum dot screens, if I recall correctly, by Samsung. So the advantage here is that those colloidal nanocrystals give us access to quantum behavior, and I will be clearer about this in the next slide, at a very, very low cost. To produce semiconductors of high quality, especially for photoemission, such as those using screens. With traditional techniques, you need basically chemical vapor deposition, molecular beam epitaxy. Those are very expensive techniques that require very advanced setups. In this case, we are basically able to cook them with little more than a kitchen setup. We literally make them with our hands in, I don't know, maybe 20 minutes, 2 hours, using wet chemistry. And also those come in the form of an ink, so you can basically print with them. Like they're like normal ink on a paper, you can print with them. And this dramatically lowers or would lower the manufacturing costs. So when I'm speaking about quantum effects, one analogy that often pops up is that quantum dots are artificial atoms. And what it means is that electronically speaking, they behave remarkably similarly. For example, if you consider the emission spectrum of an insulated gas, here is you on the upper part of the slide, you see the emission spectrum of xenon, if I recall correctly. You see those very sharp lines, and they are basically related to energy jumps in between states inside the atom. What is interesting about colloidal quantum dots is that since they are confined, those discrete states appear inside their electronic structure. And depending on their size and, of course, the composition, you can achieve very sharp and precise energy jumps as well. Of course, not as precise as an atomic gas, but on the other side, atomic gases are not really useful if you want to produce, for example, a TV screen. And this gives access to very color pure, for example, emission, and precisely tunable one. So this analogy of quantum dots as artificial atoms has been expanded a lot during the last few years to the point that, I mean, if you have an atom and you take another atom, the first thing you form is a molecule, right? So you can think of doing the same with nanocrystals. You take a nanocrystal, another nanocrystal, you bind them together with a molecule, and then you fuse them together. And that's basically what you call a quantum dot molecule. However, the most interesting collective material, if you want, that you can obtain with nanocrystals are the superlattices. So superlattices are crystals of crystals. They follow exactly the same rule as a normal crystal, but instead of using atoms, you have nanoparticles. They might seem fancy, maybe, or not really, I mean, something straightforward to think about, but they are more common than you might think. So one very famous natural example are opals. If you go in Australia and you pick up a rock from the ground, you're lucky enough, you might find one. They are beautiful, they're really fascinating, their colors are extremely bright. And those colors are not an intrinsic property of the material they are made of, but they are a collective property due to the arrangement of very small nanometric-sized silica nanospheres. Another option, another example that has been studied a lot, especially a few years ago, like 1 decade ago, is the formation of mini bands. So if you take semiconductor nanocrystals and you arrange them in a superlattice, if they're close enough, they can start electronically coupling and form states that mimic the electronic states that you would get in a crystal made of atoms. Today, I actually want to build more on this idea of superlattices as artificial crystals, but I don't want to focus on the properties because they have been studied a lot already, and they are quite difficult to obtain and control for several reasons, mostly related to the chemistry of these systems. I would actually like to talk about structure. So today we're going a bit more into crystallography. And now it's, I think, time to introduce what we actually did in our research. So the materials we study in our group mostly are those lead halide perovskite nanocrystals. They have been on the edge of research on colloidal semiconductors for quite a lot now. They are very bright, so they are very appealing for applications. But this is not really relevant. I'm going to present a method that is general to the field of colloidal nanocrystal superlattices. What you need to remember here is that those nanocrystals mostly come in two shapes that are nanocubes and nanoplatelets. And the reason will be clear in a minute. So let's start in nanocubes. When you take nanocubes, you assemble them all together. So you start from a single nanocube, you pack them together in layers, and then the layers you pack them together in crystals. You get out those brilliant green microcrystals. They're about 20 microns each, and you can cover easily a surface with them. Such system is not new. They have been studied about, I would say, 15 years, 20 years that people study colloidal nanocrystal superlattices. And the general methods that people use are GISAX, GIVAX, and if you can, this is not always usable, SIRE. So GISAX and GIVAX stand for grazing incidence, small angle or wide angle X-ray scattering. The small angle scattering that is shown here gives you information about the nanoscopic assembly. So this is basically a map of the symmetry of the superlattice. While GVAX and SIDE, they are kind of complementary twin techniques. SIDE is basically diffraction in a TEM. That's why it's not always usable, depends on how thick is your system. They give you information about the atomic structure of each nanocrystal inside. Now, those two techniques are really powerful when they are combined together. However, there is one point where they miss the target. And the problem is that they decouple the long-range periodicity of the superlattice and the atomic-range periodicity of the nanocrystal. They study them as independent. But if you could study them together in some way, maybe something interesting might come out, right? And that's actually what we found out accidentally when we started studying those materials. So the story goes that here it was still my master's thesis, actually, always in group of Libero. I was studying those nanocrystals and I prepared superlattices. And while taking powder diffraction pattern, because, I mean, in a chemistry lab, it's not that you have fancy synchrotrons lying around. You need to work with what you have, right? Especially at the start. We noticed that if you just take the diffraction pattern of randomly oriented nanocrystals, well, it looks like normal diffraction pattern of nanomaterial. But when you start taking the diffraction pattern of superlattice, you suddenly have very sharp signals at low angles, some bouncings, and most crucially, in the wide angle region, one of the Bragg peaks split. Now, we are not really talking today about the low angle region because this is the domain of GISAX and it's very well known. This is basically the periodicity of the superlattice. But what is interesting here is that the atomic range Bragg peak change in shape. And this is very weird, because what you would expect here is that your atomic structure is changing, but actually it is not. What is going on here is a multilayer diffraction effect. It is a collective diffraction mechanism that's going on. In a very short way, what happens is that like your beam comes on the nanocrystal, and each of them diffracts at a specific Bragg angle. However, since the initial beam comes coherent, comes in phase locally, but you have a vertical shift in between the layers, you now have a phase mismatch. You might be familiar with this idea because what it is, it's actually Bragg's law, right? And this creates areas where you have constructive interference. However, you cannot have intensity everywhere. You have intensity only where the nanocrystal decides to diffract. So what you came up with is a convolution of the nanocrystal diffraction profile that is very broad, plus sharp fringes coming from the superlattice. Again, this is not new. This has been studied extensively, especially in the 80s and 90s, but on completely different systems. It was studied in epitaxially grown superlattices, basically from oxides or for magnetic properties. And I would say the two most relevant contributors to the field were Professor Fullerton and Schuller, who are now at UC San Diego. And they studied this phenomenon and developed a quantitative tool to fit those diffraction patterns. This is results from their research. So the idea was, wait a second, I mean, apparently we see the same effects on colloidal nanomaterials. Would it be possible to build a similar model and extract information from that? And the answer, of course, is yes. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here talking to you. So how do we do it? We first need, I mean, it's a normal diffraction experiment, right? So when you build a diffraction model, what you do, you start from your fundamental scatterer. In a normal crystal, your fundamental scatterer is an atom. and you have the atomic form factor. But here, our fundamental scatterer is the nanocrystal. So the first thing we do, we model the nanocrystal as a bunch of atomic planes. And this is the profile that you get out. As I mentioned, so this is just depending on the nanocrystal. So it depends on what is the periodicity of the atomic lattice inside and how big the nanocrystal is. And this on its own just provides this kind of orange curve that I am comparing against the experimental data. The next step is to introduce the periodicity effect. And periodicity effect means stacking them one on the top of the other with the periodicity that we call lambda. So this creates the fringes that we actually observe. But for sure, we are not capturing the broadening of the line. And the reason is that we need to introduce disorder. So there are two kinds of disorder here. One is a fluctuation in between the internanocrystal distance that produces most of the broadening. And the second is a fluctuation in the nanocrystal size, because those are still produced by wet chemistry. And as good as we are, we always miss one in cell of two or two on average, right? So there is kind of size distribution. Apparently, this model is able to fit the experimental data, but it's not enough. We need to validate it, right? And how do we validate such a model? We need a reference, and no one actually studied this phenomenon before on nanocrystal. So what we decided to do was to perform a thermal annealing. We take the nanocrystals and we heat them up slowly. And the reason is that we want to introduce a gradual change in their structure so that we can track it and see if our model makes sense. Our model actually tracks the evolution of the diffraction peaks quite well, both at low angle and at a higher angle. And we get a list of parameters out, right? So we track the thermal expansion of the unit cell that is well in line with what is reported for same material in literature. We observe that the nanocrystals get closer to each other, which is kind of counterintuitive, but it makes sense if you think that there is still some solvent in between them that must evaporate, because those are basically created by drying a solution slowly. And also the ligands that are on the surface might want to interdigitate better. So by providing a bit of heat, you give them more mobility. But what is really, really interesting of this result is that the disorder parameter is very low already and gets lower and lower. So we are kind of annealing those crystals. So by low, I mean that the average interparticle distance fluctuation is on the order of one angstrom. And this is incredibly low, because it means that it's just one third of atomic bond. So here in those materials, the main bond that defines the structure is the lead to lead bromide bond that is 3 angstroms. And the average mismatch that we have is one third of that. It's incredibly low. And you can think of this mismatch as a sort of Debye-Waller factor or displacement atomic factor for atomic crystals. So it's kind of the same thing. We have our elemental scatter, and the elemental scatter is not precisely placed. It's some sort of mimicking this idea. So here is what we did on nanocubes. But if you recall, we were also studying nanoplatelets. Turns out that nanoplatelets, this is how they look at TM, you can do pretty much the same. You can assemble them in films, and they will produce this very sharp diffraction pattern. That's, again, counterintuitive, because a nanoplatelet is very thin. It's about 1 nanometer thin. And if you are familiar with diffraction, probably most of you are, you know that 1 nanometer of crystalline material should produce a very broad diffraction signal, while here we have very sharp ones. But again, the reason is multilayer diffraction. So here is our experimental data, and here is the simulation that we compute. And to compute this now, we need actually to model the atomic structure of the nanoplatelets. We cannot just approximate it as a bunch of layers with no chemical identity, because those are so thin that in the direction we are probing, they are basically molecules. So now we have this kind of model of a nanoplatelet where you have the surface, 1 bromine atom and 1 ligand, the first layer of atom, bromine, lead, bromine, then bromine, cesium, bromine, lead, bromine, and so on. All these is basically 1.2 nanometers. It's very, very small. Now, the need of modeling the atomic structure of the nanoplatelet is a challenge. Of course, it makes it more complicated, but it also opens a lot of opportunities, because now we can test the structure of an extremely thin nanomaterial that would be impossible to study by any conventional, like Bragg-like diffraction on its own. You would need to go to pair distribution function or total scattering. And even then, I think you're really close to what the technique can achieve, because those are really thin. They are basically molecules again. But here, since we crystallize them, now we exploit the periodicity of the superlattice to do whatever we want. So we can study, for example, how thick they are. We see that two monolayer simulations, so basically one octahedra, two octahedra, those are two monolayers, one and two. Two monolayer fit nicely the data. One monolayer completely misses the features, and three monolayer is way too sharp, so we know the thickness. We also know what is the surface termination. You can terminate a crystal of the same thickness in several ways. Like, for example, here I'm cutting on the lead bromide plane, but we are not capturing the experimental data. Now I can start cutting on a lead, on a bromide cesium layer. But again, I mean, we are doing better, but we are missing intensity here, right? When we replace the cesium with an organic molecule that is our protecting ligand on the surface, well, now we are capturing the profile much better. So we actually know, we can see one single layer of atoms. And just because, the reason is that we reproduce it periodically. We can do other stuff here. We study the disorder, but it's not really so important. It's very low disorder, half angstrom, really incredibly, impressively ordered. And basically, then you can push it to the limit and even do a sort of Ritzveld refinement if you want, but of course, it's not Ritzveld. The model is multilayer diffraction model, and get a full picture of the structure with the like octahedra tilting, distortions, unit cell parameters, and you can even study the percentage of coverage, so how defective your surface is. Now, here I have another example, but I think I'm running out of time, so I'm skipping it for the moment. We can go back. So to conclude, what I really want to show is, in case you're working with nanocrystals, you can try to assemble them. It's fairly easy. They really like to assemble. Just dry Slowell solution. And even with a simple lab-grade diffractometer, because those are all non-synchrotron experiments, imagine what you could do with a synchrotron, but even without, you can get very interesting information about the superlattice itself and also the nanocrystals they are inside the superlattice. And to conclude this idea and go and connect with what Giancarlo presented, how further can we push this idea of using superlattices as single crystal of particles? Well, the first example that comes to mind is, well, maybe we can do single crystal diffraction, right? And this is not far-fetched, because if you think of protein crystallography, those are also quite big and complex entities. They are about 2, 3, 2, 6 nanometers big. You can crystallize them and get out protein model. So maybe it would be possible to do superlattice single crystal diffraction. And actually, it has been attempted in the past with, I mean, decent results, but it was just one attempt, and they couldn't find anything else in literature. And also, you can think of making atomically precise surfaces of those nanocrystals. That might, for example, give access to other characterization techniques, such as the ones that Giancarlo showed. Those are intrinsically surface-related techniques, right? I think I've concluded now. So if you are interested to read more about our works, those are published both on ACS Nano. You will find them easily. Also because I don't have so many publications at the moment, so just type my name and those are there. And I really want to thank the people that work with me. So my professor Liberato Manna, my hands-on supervisor Dmitry Baranov, Andrei Singer from Cornell University, who helped me to understand and learn how to use this multilayer diffraction model. And of course, Cinzia, because like this project started in her lab in first place. The GISAX and GVAX data that I showed are from her lab. And basically, nothing would have been possible without their support. So I am really grateful for that. I'm grateful for you, to you, for your attention. And I think I'm open to questions now.
Great, Stefano. Thank you very much. And a very nice example of how to play with the chemistry and reaching high quality crystal, very high quality crystals. So before leaving to Giancarlo back the floor for a possible contribution to your question. So to understand if his techniques, what they provide to your sample, your problems. I again stress the audience asking if they have some questions, curiosity. You want to know the age of Stefano? Any is welcome. So don't be shy.
Don't ask this to a lady.
Nothing? Okay, so Giancarlo, what do you think of what Stefano presented? Are these samples available for your techniques? And what would you expect to provide with techniques that you have just explained us?
So I confess I was sleeping not very well this night in order to find out something that was not orthogonal to this. Because I believe that the subject is very interesting, and also the opportunities are important. So now, something that I was trying to find, if you give me the screen for a moment.
Okay, I stop the sharing. Stop the screen sharing.
Vediamo.
Okay,
Okay.
you have it.
Yes. So now I found okay, vabbè, this is something for the useful reading, but I will, in any case, the slides will be there. So there is a technique that is called that is based again on microscopy, an electron microscopy, that is X-beam or PIM-LIM, so a photoelectron-electron microscopy. So this is an old result in which, for example, on the Gold 111, they were able to see scanning over a certain surface. A difference in intensity across something like 3 nanometer. Okay, this is advertising, no? So in the normal experiment, you will never get something like that. But say, if we increase something like one or two or one and a half order of magnitude, I have the feeling that we are not very far from the size you are mentioning.
No, not at all. So the nanocrystals I'm specifically studying here, the cubes are 8.6 nanometers in edge, and we are very precise because, again, the technique we have developed is precise down to a tenth of angstrom, so we really know how big they are. Nanoplatelets are actually way easier because on the la like lateral size, nanoplatelets can reach easily microns as an extension. The confined direction is the thin one. So
Okay, so
yes, for sure.
taking into account my full ignorance on what you are doing. No,
The ignorance is really, really reciprocal, I think.
one point one important question would be, is this an interest or any, say, philosophical interest on studying the single of this or the collective? Because say, if I think about the collective properties and the diffraction, etc., obviously there is practically nothing, unless there is a if Alberto Verdini is here connected from IOM Perugia, he may explain that there is a technique called the X-ray photoelectron diffraction, where you obtain structural information from also photoemission. But I do not believe that you may have a nanometer resolution on this, no? So to some extent, the lateral resolution that you may have
Hi Giancarlo, I'm here.
eccolo qua. Ok.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Hi.
Ciao, Alberto. So you may come into my SOS, but I hardly believe that there are possibility of doing an XPD with nanometer spot.
You have to use the Hackspace and do Hackspad, okay?
Huh.
Because they are before the speaker showed us that these are cubes, 10,
yep.
13 nanometers, if I remember, something like that.
Yes, that's so correct.
For us, Giancarlo, they are big, okay? For the attraction, they are big. But if you can,
if I can
the kinetic energy, you can have the mapping, okay?
So this is a possible experiment, challenge experiment for the next.
This is a challenging experiment, and it is.
So if I can comment quickly.
No, there is no theory for such high kinetic energies. Mm-hmm. There is
okay.
Something we are not completely, unaware.
Go on.
So if I can comment, quickly on these, the individual object, yes, it's 10 nanometers in size. But keep in mind that the assemblies, so the super lattice itself, is 20 microns, and it is extremely homogeneous. Our lab source, like it's a common, theta to theta diffractometer with copper tube. We don't have, of course, nanometer resolution, so we are forced to analyze an area that will be, I don't know, millimeters square. And still, those systems are so crazily homogeneous that you are still able to see them as they were a single object. So the big advantage here, and what I really believe is the advantage of the technique we developed, is that by exploiting the intrinsic homogeneity of the sample, you don't need to go to very high spatial resolutions, because they will provide you. They will give you the collective response that you are looking for. And this is very, very true for nanocubes, where the assembly is 20 microns, but it is even more true for the nanoplatelets, where the assembly is actually centimeter size, because we completely coat the silicon wafer, that is our substrate, with an homogeneous film. There is no interruption there. So I think it's actually not much about the size.
Okay. No, this is promising in the sense that, when spring will arrive also in the United States, and
they never.
At the end of the summer, I guess you will come back.
Hopefully, yeah.
Hopefully. From this point of view, the trying to exploit both the single and the collective properties, it could be doable. It's a challenging experiment because as far as I remember, there are only probably one or two places in the world in which you may combine this need, but could be doable. The second point is that although I was mentioning the beauty of photoelectron spectroscopy, there are a bunch of other spectroscopies available at synchrotron, and probably, for example, absorption is another one where you may extract useful in information.
Mm-hmm.
Not related to diffraction, but this does not mean that they cannot have important or useful information. But in any case, I would say that one important point would be to go to some kind of lateral resolution. Say having this does not mean that you are forced to need you need forcefully 100 nanometer, but say having some few microns of spot will help.
Yes.
As far as I understand from your talk, we'll end much more understanding the fine details of all this peak fitting, no? and the way in which the evolution of, as a function of, I don't know, temperature, stress, strain. So, for example, one of the future avenues of any spectroscopy is somehow what I was mentioning for the I was giving the example of the electrical field, no? But it's mm-hmm. it's measuring while you are producing a change in your sample. So, for example,
there yes, are, I see, no, in situ techniques.
Exactly.
Or so in operando, if you
example,
want. Yes.
I would be very interested to understand or to see one of your beautiful samples under strain. What happens? No, if you. Yeah. If you try to squeeze or enlarge no, the dimension while something is happening, so
applying pressure might do something.
For example,
stretching so you
there
will
are,
lose.
There are a spectroscopy with the diamond cells in which you may do exaphs or absorption, and this is available yeah. somewhere, and probably this is not very difficult to find.
No, also, no, it's not difficult.
But also studying, even from a basic point of view, what is the difference due to the collection of the nanocrystals in terms of electronic states of the materials? So to see and to prove that these collective properties might change in some way the status, the energy status of the materials, yeah. for example. This
so you see, Giancarlo, here I think one point that is really critical, and maybe you don't see it immediately because we come from very different material fields, right? So you are used to work on a cleaved, clean surface that is well oriented, etc., right? In our case, we work on solutions, right? So what the fact that we are assembling the crystals means, it means that now they are oriented. And it means that they are now accessible for all sorts of angle resolve techniques that are impossible to use whenever your material is a powder or a liquid.
Clear.
And really something new, right? So even an experiment that for another material, for a conventional bulk material, is trivial somehow, or obvious for those materials, it has never been possible before mm-hmm. because you will never be able to orient. I mean, so far people didn't think to use super lattices as source of orientation. They are often used studied for collective properties, right? So when people do super lattices, they look for collective properties. But if you don't focus your attention too much on the need of collectivity, you actually can use them as a tool to study the individual components. That has never been done before, as far as I know, for example. Mm-hmm. So I think like explosive systems opens a lot of opportunities.
I agree. This is one of the possible, approach that one may try to explore. Yes. Yes.
So I have a couple questions for you, if you don't mind, but really quick one.
Please.
So what is the penetration depth that you can actually like realistically achieve with for example ARPES?
So ARPES is extremely surface sensitive, meaning the K space the difference between what we may say the normal photoemission and the angular resolved photoemission is that with angular resolved photoemission you enter in K space. So the region of kinetic energy in which you may enter in K-space is, I would say, from zero to some hundreds of electron volt, or probably 1,000. This corresponds mm-hmm. to 1 nanometer.
Okay. So and if you use instead hard X-rays, you can go down,
the,
right?
The hard X-ray is available at many synchrotrons now. There are even some lab sources that are very expensive. So it's better to go to a beamline than buy something like that, but it's possible. Typically the information depth, it's a complicated value, but you may range for 5 to 10 nanometer.
That would be okay for example,
but,
for one monolayer of our crystals.
Exactly, but you practically you are losing completely the K space information. So it's like
you can't have everything, right?
No, but say it, in some sense it's easy to understand. It's the sense that say the way in which you enter K space is the fact that you are able to distinguish the trajectory of an electron with a certain angular resolution, mm-hmm. and that the photoemission process gives you direct transition. See,
okay.
Simply speaking. I hope that this is not recorded, that otherwise I will be killed by someone expert in ARPES. But say, this is the idea. So now, as soon as you increase the kinetic energy, you start with a band that is a normal band, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as you increase, you have backfolding.
Sure.
And from the technological point of view, you need much more and more angular resolution in order to distinguish, to disentangle two electrons. Okay. So
okay.
At a certain point, this is the main problem. There are many others, but at a certain point, instead you have a band, you have a continuum.
Okay.
No. So
yes.
This is one of the point. There are many other parameters. For example, there is a phonon broadening. There is the Biwaller factor in which it's very difficult to distinguish. At certain point, you have to measure as a function of the system that you would like to measure, or the element. You need to go to 1 Kelvin, and it's impossible to measure the 1 Kelvin. But say, in general, for normal people and normal experiment, you may say that you may keep the K dispersion up to several hundred of electron volt, meaning 1 nanometer or something more, and you may keep the information about the electronic properties by using core level instead of valence band up to 10 nanometer.
That's within our range.
What Alberto was mentioning is that if you would like to exploit X-ray for the electron diffraction, you may exploit it even at higher energies because you sit on a core level.
Okay.
So in some sense, if you have a very good control of your sample and you spend the angles, you may extract and obtain, say, some kind of pattern that is corresponding to diffraction. So this is
okay.
doable, in my opinion. And also, I would really suggest you to check for example, anvil cell or diamond cell.
Giancarlo?
Or the pressure.
Giancarlo? While you were speaking, I got an idea. Maybe it's wrong because you were speaking. during an experiment using the crystal of the nanocrystals, the super lattice, in a standing wave experiment.
Expert on standing waves, but we may ask experts. Yes.
I'm not an expert, but it would be another nice experiment to perform. But I have a question to Stefano, if I can. Because
sure,
you showed also that your parameter, your sigma of the nanocrystal was, you were moving your nanocrystal with respect to each other by, I mean, along zeta direction.
Yes, correct.
You can add also the XY and also some rotation of your object, because you know the
okay.
randomness can be. It's
sure, okay. So the point is, when we perform these experiments that I showed, we were scanning. So it was a theta to theta experiment, and the scattering vector was perpendicular to the surface of the sample. So in that configuration, you were blind. You are blind to the in-plane information. So we couldn't probe it, right? Now, now we are doing some other experiments that are going on synchrotrons, where we have like aerial detector in a different configuration. We might get something out. However, it will be challenging because in a vertical direction, all the superlattices are oriented in the same way, right? They point up and they are flat on the surface, so it's easy to like probe them. In the other directions, they are randomly rotated, so you lose coherence. It's a bit more complicated. What is fair to assume, also by high resolution imaging in TEM, in SEM, what is fair to assume is that the lateral ordering is comparable, basically. So we can probe one direction, but we can guess that in the other directions it will be similar. Maybe a bit less ordered, but similar.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Are there any other questions from? Oh, sorry.
it would be nice to measure it. Okay.
Yeah, it would be nice. Actually, we were thinking that the transmission measurement, like if we could assemble them on a transparent substrate, like transparent to X-rays, of course, tilt them and have a transmission measurement, then we might be able to get something out. But then you need a micro-sized beam because you need actually to measure one superlattice at the point. You cannot afford measuring more than one because otherwise you will have this rotation, you will get a powder pattern now, right? So you need the transmission on a micro source, which is a bit challenging also because unfortunately those materials are very fragile. So the fact that you have organic molecules on the surface of the nanocrystal is needed, otherwise you cannot make them. But their consistency at touch is that of soft butter. So as soon as you try to do anything with them, you basically spread them and they become a jam. It's quite difficult to manipulate them. That's actually why when Giancarlo was suggesting Envil cell, I was actually more thinking to apply a pressure through gases, because if you touch them with an Envil cell, they are dead. But if you put them in a high pressure environment, well, then it might be different.
Okay, this
Okay.
is okay. Now I
Thank
understand.
you.
So, is there any question maybe from the audience?
No. Okay, so I will go to the end of the meeting, and I want to thanks very much Giancarlo Pancione and Stefano Tosio for being the first speaking of this new idea of the civil society. And I want to thank all of you for attending this meeting. So see you next time.
Grazie mille.
Thank you, Cinzia.
Ciao.
Bye. Bye, everyone.
Ciao. Grazie ancora.
Grazie,
Bye.
Alberto.
Ciao, ciao.
Ciao.